Hello and welcome to a very special episode of To The Point. 10 days after stepping down as Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, my guest today is Najeeb Jung, and he's agreed to speak openly and candidly about his relations with Arvind Kejriwal and the Delhi government, Narendra Modi and the central government, the power and role of the Lieutenant Governor in Delhi, and issues of concern to the Muslim community. This is Mr. Jung's first and so far only interview after resigning as Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. Mr. Jung, let me start with your surprise resignation last month. Although you've repeatedly said it was done willingly and voluntarily, many people, including the Congress Party, have refused to believe you. They insist you were either pushed or forced to resign by the Modi government. How can you convince them that was not the case?
Delhi is a city, I think, of intrigue, innuendo and rumor. And so this rumor will continue, I guess. The truth of the matter is that I met the Prime Minister on the 28th of May, 2 days after he was sworn in. And at that point, I had said that since I had been appointed by the earlier government, if he wished, I could move on. And he had asked me to continue. Subsequently, this year, or rather last year, in August, after the court judgment, when things had got sorted out substantially and I had done 3 years, I again met him and I said that, look, I've done 3 years, I would like to move on. And he said that we'll talk about it at the end of the year. So at the end of the year, I met him again and I made the same request and he agreed.
So 3 times you wanted to resign. On the first 2 occasions, the Prime Minister was reluctant and wouldn't accept. On the third, he accepted.
That is right.
So you're really saying to me, because this is the bit that Congress and many find hard to believe, that you were tired of being LG, that you wanted to reclaim your private life, and you now look forward to a retirement where you can read and write. That is really the truth?
I believe that life has its own chapters, its own phases. This was an interesting phase. It's now over. There is a couplet which I recited to my office friends. Wo afsana jise anjaan tak lana na ho mumkin, usse khoobsurat murde kar chhodna acha. This was a chapter. It has come to an end. There is nothing more to it.
You've put it very poetically, and I will accept your explanation. But let me put it to you that there are many in India who will say, this is not the way Indians behave. We're a country where people cling to jobs, to power, to position. You've voluntarily given up one of the most important ones when you had 1.5 years more to go, and the Prime Minister was happy for you to continue.
Well, this is the 5th time I have given up jobs. I gave up the IAS quite voluntarily. I gave up a job in the Asian Development Bank very voluntarily. I quit Oxford University voluntarily. So this is not new to me. I really believe in chapters and phases.
You really are a giver up of good jobs.
I will start another chapter of my life, hopefully.
Can you say what that will be?
I have no idea. No idea at all.
Absolutely no idea.
Absolutely no idea.
So you've taken a leap into what many would consider the void.
Like I said, ke sara sara, we will wait and see what happens.
Let's then look back on the 3.5 years you spent as Lieutenant Governor. And my first question is, why did you have such a fractious, such a publicly acrimonious relationship with the Chief Minister of Delhi, Arvind Kejriwal?
I often think about it myself, and now in the last 10 days I've had time to retrospect. I think on Mr. Kejriwal's side it was exuberance of age, perhaps initial steps that you take in politics and therefore a bit of inexperience. An approach that since you had this overwhelming majority, you could do as you please. All we tried at every step was to try to curb tendencies to play with the Constitution or to interpret the Constitution in a manner that he thought was correct and which we believed was not.
You're putting the blame almost entirely on Arvind Kejriwal.
Yes, I am, because in my 2 years of association with him and in the earlier 49 days, I do not remember anything that we did which was really an initiative to actually antagonize the Delhi government. Every step was taken by them.
So the fault and the wrongs were on Arvind Kejriwal's side, not yours?
I would not use the word wrong. I would say that it was excitement to move at a pace when he did not know that government has its own pace and its own momentum. Again, I quoted Ghalib to him one day and I said, Hazaro khwahish hai aisi ki har khwahish pe dam nikle. You know, you have a lot of desires, but you can't fulfill all of them.
So it was his inexperience? It was his somewhat arrogant attitude to the fact that he had an overwhelming majority, the size of which no one has had before, and it was his age, what you call exuberance of age, that were the real problems.
Yes, I believe that he's a young man in a hurry to perform, and perhaps with time it will get tempered.
But looking back, do you think as Lieutenant Governor you could have handled things better? Is there any point at which, when you look back, you could say to yourself, perhaps I could have done this differently?
When you look back, perhaps you always think that you could have done things differently. I called him several times, we spoke to him, I called him home, I went to his house. Maybe I could have tried more. How can I say today? I genuinely believe that I did not want any conflict, because conflict does not get us anywhere. It has to be by mutual cooperation that we can move.
So you tried your very best, but you weren't able to make this a harmonious relationship?
I believe I did try my best.
What was the relationship behind closed doors when the press and the world wasn't listening and watching you? What was your private relationship with Arvind Kejriwal like?
My private and personal relationships with Mr. Kejriwal were extremely cordial. Like I said, he has visited my home, which is unusual. I mean, if there was so acrimony, why would he come home? I have visited his house. His father was unwell, I went and called on them. He comes from an absolutely lovely family. And we never had even an iota of an argument when we met in private. We would disagree on views, and he would inform me a lot on his views on politics. So, but it was always on file or in public when he spoke, that he spoke acrimoniously.
So the public persona of Arvind Kejriwal, you're suggesting, is very different to the private one?
Well, that may be so of many politicians.
I must put this to you. As the people of Delhi, and then increasingly the people of India, almost daily watch the acrimony between the two of you, the public squabbling between the two of you, most people came to the conclusion that you were both behaving like children, not mature adults. How do you respond to that viewpoint?
I can't really say. Like I said, that I have never spoken publicly on any matter. My actions were only on file.
But would you accept that this has damaged both of you?
I don't see how it has damaged me. People would have thought that the elected government was not allowed to function. But that is the limitation of the Constitution. The Constitution makes the administrator as the head of the Delhi government. And I had to protect the Constitution, because my oath is to defend and protect the Constitution.
In other words,
I did it at every step.
In other words, he left you no option but to behave and to respond as you did.
If I sat on every file today, I would behave exactly in the same manner.
Now, in August 2016, when the Delhi High Court upheld your interpretation of your role vis-a-vis his role as Chief Minister, you appointed the Shunglu Committee to go into some 450 files where decisions had been taken by the Kejriwal government without the concurrence or consultation with the LG. I want to talk about that. First of all, why did you feel a need to appoint this committee?
See, when the judgment came, we were aware that a large number of decisions had been taken in the previous 1.5 years, which was not strictly legal or correct or constitutional. Now, those decisions either had to be rectified, which means given post facto approval, or they had to be nullified if they were incorrect. So we wrote to the government, we wrote to all the secretaries that please send us files that you think you have acted wrongly, and the files that came to us were sent by them. So it was an admission of fact by the secretaries and the ministers that they had illegally acted.
When they sent the files, they were admitting that?
They were admitting that.
And
every file said so.
And how many did they send?
They sent about 464 odd files. Which, now coming to the Shunglu committee, or it was not a Shunglu committee, it was a committee of three senior people. It didn't have a chairman. It's been called the Shunglu committee because Shunglu sahab is the senior most of them. I selected those people because these were people with absolutely unimpeachable credentials. Now, why did I have this committee? Had I started looking at every file and taking a decision, you would have sat here today and said that you had a bias, you were turning down things, this is an elected government and so on, and I would have been put in public domain for criticism. So what I did was that we appointed this committee. This committee looked at files. 64 files they returned straight away, or 60 files, saying that, look, decisions haven't been taken on these, you can send them back. We sent them back.
Leaving roughly
404 left.
404 left. Now, the Shungruk Committee presented its report to you several weeks before you actually resigned.
Yep.
Why did you not make it public?
The Shungruk Committee, again, we keep saying Shungruk Committee, is really, it is not a commission of inquiry. It is a committee of three people set up to advise the lieutenant governor on how to proceed on matters. Therefore, to my mind, there was no need to put this into public domain. Should you want to see it, you can see it. I mean, ask for it in the RTI. There's no secret about it.
So it's not a secret report?
It is not a secret document at all.
And it can be accessed through RTI?
It can be.
So anyone listening to this interview who wants to access it can put in an RTI request, and hopefully your successor, Mr. Bejal, will make the report available.
I believe he would.
You believe he would?
Yes.
Let's actually come to the Shungruk Committee report. I believe it categorized the decisions taken by the Kejriwal government in those remaining 404 files under three separate categories.
Yes.
What were those three categories?
They said that there was a category of files where decisions were taken by the chief minister, which he was not authorized to do, and he should have got concurrence of the or approval of the lieutenant governor. Second category were files that the chief minister and the cabinet took decisions, and they hadn't sought the approval of the lieutenant governor. And the third category was that the chief minister and the cabinet took decisions which they were not authorized to take at all.
So
three categories.
So the decisions in the 404 files that eventually were examined by the Shungruk Committee fell into these three categories.
Yes, that is right.
Of those 404 files, how many did you clear before you resigned, and how many have you left for Mr. Bejal?
I think I have approved or given post facto approval to about 170, 180 files. But I have remarked on each one of them that I wish the decision had been taken with my approval, because this is not the way that a democratic system should work.
So in
but
other
I have given post facto approval.
So you've given post facto approval,
yes,
to 175, 176 files with the note that the decision should have been taken with your approval.
Absolutely.
Not without your approval.
Yes.
Nonetheless, you're giving retrospective approval.
That is right.
How many files did you reject or decline your approval to?
I think I declined about 80.
80 were declined?
Yes.
Which means that the total number of files that you handled were roughly 175 plus 80, which comes roughly to about 250.
That is right.
Which means 150 have been left for Mr. Bejal.
Yes, I think by the time I was leaving, more or less 100 odd had also been processed in my office. So the decision would be coming very soon.
So it's a much easier process for Mr. Bejal, because you've done the processing.
I have done the processing. It's done by the office. Bejal Sahab would have to think and reflect on how to look at them. I mean, he will take an independent view.
You've told me about how many files there were. You've told me how many you cleared. You've told me how many decisions you post facto retrospectively approved of.
Yeah.
You've also told me about how many you declined.
Yes.
Were there files where decisions were taken by the Kejriwal government which were deemed by you to be improper and sent either for investigation or for vigilance or for CBI inquiry?
Yes, there are several.
When you say several, how many?
I think the CBI is already looking at 7 or 8 cases. 2 or 3 more must be in the pipeline. I mean, I suppose Bejal Sahab would have a look at them. I think another dozen or so we would have turned down for the Vigilance Department to be examining on their own.
So 7 or 8 have been sent to the CBI by you directly?
Yeah.
2 or 3 more you think Mr. Bejal will send in due course?
Yeah.
And another dozen or so have been sent for vigilance inquiry?
That is right.
Which means, if my maths is correct, there are some roughly 22, 23 decisions taken by the Kejriwal government where either vigilance inquiry is needed or outright CBI inquiry.
CBI, like I said, is already looking at 8 or 9. They have registered FIRs in, I think, 2 or 3. They have registered what they call a preliminary inquiry in another 3 or 4.
The FIRs that they've registered, under what section were they registered? Do you know?
cheating, nepotism. I don't remember the exact sections, but this is what it amounts to. I mean, I remember the cases offhand.
These are clear criminal cases.
These are cases of malfeasance, which are punishable under the Criminal Procedure Code.
Now, there are five instances of cases that have been raised by what I call the Shunglu Committee that I want to discuss with you. Mm-hmm. I want to take you through each of them individually. Mm-hmm. The first concerns an individual called Dr. Nikhunj Agarwal, who is said to be a relative of Arvind Kejriwal's wife. What did the Shunglu Committee find about Nikhunj Agarwal, and why is it troubling?
See, when we looked at the file, I mean, after it came from Mr. Shunglu, we found that Mr. Agarwal had approached the health minister, and on a plain piece of paper, something like you were holding in your hand, had written on an application that he wants to be appointed as a resident doctor. And so this Chacha Nehru Bal Chikitsalaya or whatever was, or the director was called and said, appoint him as a resident doctor. Appointments in governments cannot be done by any individual. Let's understand this. If I or the Prime Minister or the President of India want to appoint anyone, they will have to follow a process. Mr. Jain called the director of the hospital and said, appoint him, and that fellow was appointed. Subsequently, within I think a week of his being appointed there, he was taken as officer on special duty in Mr. Jain's office. Now, all the time he's not a regular employee, he's only what you call a temporary kind of a special employee. I think within 3 or 4 weeks of that, they sent him off on a tour to China. Now, no temporary employee goes off on a tour of China in a government delegation. And on coming back, he's sent off on a 3-week or a 4-week course to IIM Ahmedabad for a training of 4 weeks or 3 weeks. Now, all this is highly irregular.
It smacks of favoritism.
It smacks of nepotism and gross favoritism. It violates Section 16 of the Constitution, which is that equal opportunity has been given to others. Having said that, there is no post to be appointed like that.
So he was appointed to a post that didn't exist, and that appointment was irregular.
Absolutely.
It was nepotism, it was favoritism, it breaches the Constitution.
Yes, Section 16.
What action did you take in this case?
We sent it to the Vigilance Department of Delhi government. They examined it, and they sought our approval to send it off to the CBI.
And has it gone to the CBI?
The CBI has, I think, already registered an inquiry on it.
So an inquiry has been registered?
Yeah.
But has an FIR been filed as yet?
I think in this case, yes.
It has been filed?
Yes.
Do you know under what subjects, under what sections?
No, I mean, these must be regular sections.
Now, given that the Aam Aadmi Party came to power on an anti-corruption platform, and given by its very name, it rules in the name of the Aam Aadmi, do you believe that this deliberate attempt to be favorable in its treatment to Arvind Kejriwal's wife's relative at the very least suggests that they've weakened their mandate or betrayed it and perhaps damaged and dented their image?
I again do not want to use the word deliberate. I would say that this is excitement of power, that we've come into power with huge numbers, that these are little things we can do, these are favors we can do, they perhaps don't know the system, I don't know. I would like to give them the benefit of the doubt. It's for the courts to prove that now.
The second case that arises out of the Shunglu Committee is that of Soumya Jain, Health Minister Satyendra Jain's daughter. What has the Shunglu Committee said about this lady?
Again, she's an architect by profession. So she writes to Mr. Jain, her father, that I'm an architect and I'll advise you on the construction of Mohalla clinics. So she's appointed. And then all hell breaks loose because some television channel broke the story that she's the daughter. She had been given, and they said that, you know, she's accepted some money. Mr. Jain said she has not accepted any money, but we later found out she had, but that money was returned.
So Mr. Jain was misleading when he said...
That was an incorrect statement. This is again a case of nepotism.
What action have you taken in this case?
CBI.
Have they registered an FIR?
Yes.
Now, the third case that arises out of the Shunglu Committee concerns the appointment of the chairman of the Delhi Waqf Board, as well as further appointments he made, some 30 or 40 that he made. Why is that irregular, and what has the Shunglu Committee said about it?
Firstly, the chairman himself's appointment was irregular by Mr. Kejriwal. because the appointment of the chairman of the Waqf board must necessarily be done with the approval of the lieutenant governor. That was not done. Then this fellow goes and appoints a CEO, a retired IPS officer, as CEO of the Waqf board at some salary which was unacceptable. That was irregular. Then he leases out properties of the Waqf board in an irregular manner. And finally, he appoints, I think, 40 or 43 people in an irregular manner. That case also, that FIR is with the CBI.
An FIR has been filed, yes, by the CBI.
Yes.
The fourth case is to do with the chairperson of the Delhi Commission for Women, Swati Maliwal.
Mm-hmm.
What has the Shunglu Committee said about that?
Shunglu Committee has not commented on Maliwal. It's an independent complaint by a BJP MLA, Mr. Vijayendra Gupta, on the matter. And that, Mr. Gupta sent it to the Anti-Corruption Bureau of Delhi government. And the Anti-Corruption Bureau has actually charge-sheeted her already, because she had appointed some 85 odd people, some of whom actually were Aam Aadmi volunteers and workers.
In other words, jobs for their own party men.
Without the actual creation of those jobs, without the approval of government, completely irregular.
This is tantamount to nepotism.
This amounts to favoritism, nepotism, cheating, all kinds of things.
Now the fifth case, and some would say this is the most bizarre but also the most perplexing and very possibly the most worrying, and it's been thrown up by the Shunglu Committee, is to do with what's called a feedback unit. Sometimes it's referred to as a secret service unit created by the Arvind Kejriwal government in total secrecy. Tell me about this.
I think it was in March or April of 2015. When a cabinet note suddenly surfaced, in a detailed one, some 30 odd pages, which said that a large number of people would be recruited, some 250 odd, and they would be provided with jeeps, they would be provided with surveillance equipment, telephones, computers, whatever, for purposes of checking corruption. Some television channel broke this story, and because it sounded as horrendous as you are making it sound, the Kejriwal government balked and they did not take it to the cabinet. 4 months or 5 months later, I think they changed their mind, and this unit was set up through a cabinet resolution, put up through a tabled item, which means that it has not been examined by the departments, in a smaller form, meaning recruiting a fewer number of people and having fewer cars and so on. So it is worrying that that unit was to report only to the Chief Minister. When it came to our notice, we were very alarmed. We asked the Vigilance Department that how this has happened and give us details of this unit. What reports have they submitted? In the course of 1 year, we have not come across a single report that they have submitted. They are being paid. They have been housed somewhere. And to the best of my knowledge, their reports may be with the Chief Minister.
There is a suggestion in the reports or rumors about this unit that it is an attempt at spying or keeping tabs on a whole variety of entities, individuals, offices, institutions. Is that your suspicion?
I don't know enough, but certainly that is a suspicion, and that is why the CBI is probing this. They have also, I think, registered an FIR on this.
So of all the misdemeanors, if I can use that euphemism, that the Shunglu Committee has investigated, this looks like being perhaps potentially the most serious and most damaging.
No state government can put up a counter IB unit like this.
And this is tantamount to a counter IB unit.
It comes to, I mean, if they are having surveillance over me or you, then it's completely illegal.
And Arvind Kejriwal or any other chief minister of Delhi simply doesn't have the power to set this up.
No, not at all.
So it's a complete breach of the constitution and it's total abuse of power in your eyes.
Look. This is complete right to privacy. It's a very serious matter. I cannot tap your phone. So any phone that is tapped in the country would have to have specific permission only in case if we suspect that this is a terrorist activity. I cannot, because I dislike you, start tapping your phone.
And this feedback unit had the potential or the power
to do that? I have no idea. I hope not.
But that's your fear. That's your fear.
It's a generic fear, and that is why the FIR.
An FIR has been lodged?
Yes.
By the CBI?
That is right.
Do you know what sections it covers?
I don't know. It must be right to privacy and so on.
Now, if I'm correct, The Arvind Kejriwal government passed at least two resolutions seeking to declare the Shunglu Committee illegal. It's also tried to get a court to scrap the Shunglu Committee, but that didn't happen. Clearly, Arvind Kejriwal does not accept the legality of the Shunglu Committee, and he's not going to accept any findings it comes up with either. Does that worry you?
There are no findings, and there is no question of legality or illegality to the committee. The committee was formed to help the chief, the lieutenant governor. Committees are formed all the time. It left me really puzzled on why the Kejriwal government was so alarmed at the setting up of this committee. They even went to court. That stopped their working. It didn't happen. The courts didn't agree. The committee has submitted its report. Nothing has happened. We are 60% of the committee's recommendations have been acted upon. So there is nothing left in that argument anymore.
But if these FIRs proceed in the way in which FIRs tend to do, yeah, Arvind Kejriwal will face legal problems and possibly criminal charges.
That is possible.
In other words, there is a huge cloud on the horizon of the Delhi Chief Minister.
There are cases that are being investigated. Should the cases come to fruition and charge sheets be filed, and should the courts find that there is substance in the charge sheets, then he would have a problem.
Let's take a break at that point. When I come back, Mr. Jung, I want to turn and talk to you about your relationship with Narendra Modi and the central government, Rajnath Singh, the Home Minister, Arun Jaitley, the Finance Minister. But also I want to talk to you about the role of the LG and about certain issues of concern to the Muslim community in India, triple talaq. As I said, Mr. Jung, let's come to your relationship with the Modi government. How would you describe your relationship with the Prime Minister during the 2.5 years you served as Lieutenant Governor under him?
My relationship with the Honorable Prime Minister was what a relationship should be between the Lieutenant Governor of a Union Territory and the Prime Minister of India.
Were you ever under any pressure? Were you ever nudged, winked, or pushed or encouraged to take improper action against the Delhi government, or to take a hard line against the Delhi government, or to adopt a particular posture?
In my 3.5 years, which includes the Congress government and then subsequently this government, never once have I been pushed by any minister to take action against the Delhi government or to act in the interests that are contrary to the functioning of the Delhi government.
Arvind Kejriwal has repeatedly said that you were a cat's paw for Narendra Modi, that you were acting at his behest, and he's excused you on the grounds that you were required to do this. Are you saying to me, in no way, by hint or speech or in any other way, did the Prime Minister or the Prime Minister's office ever say, do this, do that, take this posture against the Delhi government?
In my private meetings with Arvind, I always told him that I am under no pressure. He never believed me. I can again reiterate the same, that the Prime Minister or any of his cabinet ministers or his office have never spoken to me to act in the interests which are contrary to the interests of the Delhi government.
Did you ever get phone calls? Did you ever get suggestion and advice either from the Prime Minister's Principal Secretary, Nupendra Mishra, or the National Security Advisor, Ajit Doval, about how to behave with or how to treat the Delhi government or how to treat Arvind Kejriwal himself?
No, never.
At all? Never?
Never at all.
Because as you know, there have been rumors and speculation that Nupendra Mishra or Ajit Doval would ring up and tell you what to do vis-a-vis Arvind Kejriwal. You're saying those rumors, that speculation is totally unfounded.
Absolutely unfounded. I have spoken to Mr. Nipen Mishra several times on several issues, but never on tightening of screws, etc. With Mr. Doval, my relationship has been completely formal. I have called on him a couple of times, but he has nothing to do with Delhi.
And neither gentleman ever gave you any idea or suggestion or any hint about how to treat Kejriwal or his government?
I wouldn't have accepted anyway had they said anything.
But they didn't either?
No.
What about Home Minister Rajnath Singh? Did he ever ask you to take moral or constitutional steps that you would have considered incorrect?
Never. Mr. Rajnath Singh, I think, is a gentleman to his fingertips. He's a good man. I have met him many, many times. I used to seek time with him maybe once a month. I used to brief him on what's happening in Delhi. He, like you yourself suggested in the initial part of the interview, would always say, you know, this is politics. We have to be patient. He has never on his own said that we have to precipitate anything.
Did he ever ask for what might be considered improper favors?
Never. Mr. Rajnath Singh, he's the Home Minister of India, has never even asked for the transfer of a sub-inspector or an inspector or a DCP or a joint CP. Never at all.
What about the other important member of this government, Arun Jaitley? What sort of relationship did you have with the finance minister?
I have been to Mr. Jaitley several times, initially during president's rule on matters of finance. Subsequently, I have been to him to seek legal advice on issues. But he has never counseled me or advised me on anything against the Kejriwal government.
Even when he had problems with the Delhi Cricket Association, which became public and in the press, did he ever ask you for any favors?
Never.
Never at all?
Never at all.
So your relationship with the Modi government, from the Prime Minister, the Prime Minister's office, through to the Home Minister, the Finance Minister, and any other minister, and I repeat, and any other minister, has been perfectly correct and proper.
I must say this, that in my 2.5 years, I have never had a request from any cabinet minister, leave apart Delhi government, for any favor that is unusual or incorrect. I mean, I'm not talking of, you know, somebody calling me and saying that get a freehold done on a leasehold property. Those things keep happening all the time because people are harassed. But never on an official matter, no.
Let's broaden our discussion. How do you view the performance and functioning of the Modi government since May 2014?
That is not for me to answer. I mean, as a lieutenant governor, it would not be appropriate at all for me to
As an ex-lieutenant governor, you're now an individual in your own right.
Even then, I have worked for 2 years in an official capacity. I would not like to comment.
Does the Narendra Modi government have a bias against Muslims, as many Muslims and many others believe and think?
In my own interactions with the Prime Minister, I found no bias. I have had long, long discussions with him. Even on issues of relationships with Muslims, I found no bias. He is concerned, and I am concerned, that the Muslims have a concern on their relationships with the BJP. I believe a lot of onus lies with the Muslim community also, because if you look back in the last 40 years, the Muslims have not produced a leader of their community. So perhaps Maulana Azad, Hafiz Ibrahim, Sayyid Mahmood, even Dr. Faridi. But Faridi died in 1973. It's a gap of 40, 50 years. It's a community without leaders. And their leaders today, what? Mr. Bahugna, Mr. Mulayam Singh Yadav? This is not the way for a community that large to be functioning. So how do they break this? Who goes to the Prime Minister to explain their perspective?
But you began your answer by saying that Mr. Modi himself was concerned about this.
Yes, he is concerned about it.
He expressed his concern to you?
He has expressed his concern to me that he would like to win them over, but who is talking to him?
When there were moments of communal tension in Delhi, such as happened in Trilokpuri, I believe, in October 2014, what was the response and attitude of the Modi government?
I must again reiterate that we have had several incidents. The Trilokpuri was a bad one. We have never, and again I would reiterate that, been under any influence of any government functionary to function this way or that way. In Trilokpuri, we made a lot of arrests. I think we made about 40 Muslim arrests and about 40 or 45 Hindu arrests. We went into houses belonging to both communities.
But there was no interference from the Modi
government?
There was
no interference at all. There was a panchayat arranged, organized, I remember, by a section of the Hindu community. It was the joint CP of police who stood there and said that there will be no misbehavior against Muslims. And if there is misbehavior, then he said that I will shoot and I will not shoot at feet. So the response of the Delhi government has been tough on any situations coming from any community.
Now, you also served as Lieutenant Governor for the last 8 months of Sheila Dixit's tenure.
Yes.
What was it like working with her, and how different was it to Arvind Kejriwal?
I had a wonderful relationship with her. It was pleasurable, if I may say so. We never disagreed on file. If there was an issue, I would keep the file aside, because every Wednesday she would visit me at 11 a.m.
Every single Wednesday?
Every single Wednesday she would visit me at 11 a.m. She would have coffee with me. We would talk about Delhi. She was exceptionally pleasant. I would keep some files in which I had doubts. We resolved them over file. If I disagreed, then she would take them back. If she could convince me, I would agree to those. So there was never a moment of acrimony.
Did Arvind Kejriwal continue this practice of meeting you as Sheila Dixit had done every Wednesday at 11?
Yes, I suggested to Arvind that, you know, she comes every Wednesday, so why don't you start coming? And he did come for a few weeks, and after that he stopped.
And then he stopped?
Yes.
And you're saying to me that handling disagreements and differences with Mrs. Dixit was very different to handling those disagreements and differences with Arvind Kejriwal. It became painful and acrimonious with Kejriwal. With Sheila Dixit, it was resolved amicably over a cup of coffee every Wednesday.
That's why I go back to the first part of your interview, that how much am I to blame?
In other words, your good relationship with Sheila Dixit exonerates you from blame in the case of your relationship with Arvind Kejriwal.
Well, I believe that in 44 years of my experience in government, I have not had acrimonious relations with anyone.
Now, you've been Lieutenant Governor for 3.5 years. Do you believe the role of the Lieutenant Governor needs to alter? Should more powers be given to the Chief Minister in Delhi?
Karan, this has been discussed time and time again, and the final discussion was in 1991 when the government of India had set up a committee called the Balkishan Report. And that report was discussed in Parliament, and they found that the constitutional setup of Delhi should remain, and it should remain as a union territory under the overall control of the central government. I believe that is a system that works, and it should continue.
As you know, every single party that's come to power in Delhi, the BJP, the Congress, the Aam Aadmi Party, at some point or other have demanded full statehood for the capital. You've been Lieutenant Governor of the capital. Do you believe full statehood is sensible, or do you believe it would be wrong?
I believe that Delhi in its current form should continue, and because it is the capital. And there are arguments for and against it. I belong to the camp that is for a union territory status.
So you are against full statehood for the capital?
I would say that the current form is quite good.
And you don't see the need for any changes in the power and role of the LG either?
No, not at all.
The present situation is fine by you?
That's right.
We have 5 minutes left. I want to come now to two issues of concern to the Muslim community. The first is the question of triple talaq. As an individual, as an enlightened Muslim, as someone who's thought deeply about his faith, and I know you are a deeply religious man in your personal view, do you believe triple talaq is immoral and it should be declared unconstitutional? Or is this an issue that should be left to Muslims to judge for themselves and no one else should interfere? Which of the two?
I think the Muslims should have come forward themselves and said that this is now a system that should be discontinued. I believe it is retrograde. I believe it is not in the interest of women. I think that Muslim women should have as much and as many rights as Muslim men, and therefore I would have thought that Parliament itself should take a view on this. If the Parliament, and I dare say I am using the word at the risk of annoying people, if Parliament doesn't have the courage to upset the Muslim community, then the courts must certainly step in.
In other words, if Parliament won't act, and as you said, it may be a question of courage, which is why Parliament is not acting. They don't want to offend the Muslims.
Yes.
Then the courts must step in.
They must step in. They should have done so before.
In other words, triple talaq is immoral and wrong, and it must be declared unconstitutional, either legislatively or through a judicial process.
I didn't say immoral, because that is part of the religion. I think it's retrograde. I think it is archaic, and it should go.
What about the Uniform Civil Code? As you know, the present government has referred the matter for consideration to the Law Commission. Is the time right for India to legislate and create a uniform civil code, or would that be unwise?
The conception of the Uniform Civil Code actually is mislaid, because the Uniform Civil Code applies to all communities, it is just not the Muslims. I mean, why think that only it will apply to Muslims? So I think it is time for communities to sit together, like a small constituent assembly of various religious leaders, to sit together and to resolve this matter. I would not like to ram it down the throat of any community, Muslim, Christian, Sikh, whatever. It should really come for them. Coming to the Muslims specifically, you know, if the community feels besieged, I would not like to further provoke it into an inferiority complex that we are being banged any further. So if the Muslim community should come up with amendments themselves, fine. Otherwise, let it come from a group of leaders of all communities getting together and saying, this is fine, we will accept this, maybe later.
If I read you correctly, this is not an area where politicians should take the initiative.
I think the initiative should come from the communities, and it should be a very gradual process of change.
What happens if the communities don't take the initiative?
Then I think that the members of the religious groups, I mean, people like me and you, will get together and say, okay, look, it's time for change.
But in other words, civil society must take the first step, not politicians.
That is right.
Mr. Jung, you've been extremely generous with your time. You've been extremely open and candid in expressing your views about Arvind Kejriwal and the Delhi government, Narendra Modi, Rajnath Singh, Arun Jaitley, and the central government. You've also spoken at length and revealed greater details about what the Shunglu Committee has reported and why it's of concern. I'm deeply grateful for this interview.
Pleasure, sir. Pleasure.